We're so glad that so many of you could come tonight. I'd like to call the meeting to order tonight. This is a Board of Finance meeting where we will have a presentation for the town to hear the budgets that are being proposed by both the Board of Education and the Board of Selectmen. But this is our meeting, so we will conduct it as a Board of Finance meeting. And let's begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. Would you all rise, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So the first order of business will be to give you, Sean, you want to pull up the next slide? Thank you. We're going to go through a few things tonight. The first is that you get to listen to me talk about the budget process. We do this every year, but I think it's educational to understand how the boards work and sort of where we are in this process. Then we'll hear from Lisa Hevner, who will give us a presentation on the Town Board of Selectmen budget, from Tara Willerup, who will present the Board of Ed budget, and then Jeff Shea and Burke LeClaire will talk about the capital budgets. After those presentations, we will then have a public audience, and we would appreciate everyone who has something to contribute or questions to ask to please come up over on the other side. We do not actually have a sign-up sheet. Oh, you either side, Joan, yes. That's your side? Yeah. We would really appreciate it as you think about your questions or comments that you try to contain them to 3 minutes. We'll give it a little leeway, but there's quite a few people here, and we want to be sure that everybody gets accommodated. All right? After the public audience, we're not going to interact in a question and answer period, but if there are questions raised during your questions or comments, we will then let the appropriate person come back and try to address them if that's helpful. Well, let's begin by understanding sort of who these three boards are and how they work together. I think that the boards, at least since I've been active on them, have worked very hard at trying to work together. We represent different constituencies in town, that the Board of Ed plays a key role in providing services to students and to parents and to taxpayers by providing a quality education to our students. The Board of Selectmen's role is to provide services for the town, and these things you'll hear about tonight, the broad level of services, and to serve both the needs and wants and requirements of the town. The Board of Finance is tasked with maintaining a strong credit rating in town, helping set the tax and mill rate, and being sure that we are fiscally responsible and keep a high credit rating. Each of these boards have their own but overlapping constituents, stakeholders, if you will. A lot of people in town are both parents and taxpayers. Some of them are also work for the town. But we're trying to find a balance then between these stakeholders, and each may have a little bit different view of where and how we should or could spend the money of the town. I think that there's by nature some conflict in this, and so as a result, we have to work as three boards cooperatively. The Board of Finance specifically is responsible for conducting a public hearing on the proposed budgets, which we're doing tonight. We approve both these budgets after they've been proposed and approved by their respective boards. And when we do that, it's our job to be sure as the Board of Finance that these are fiscally responsible budgets. And then it's our job to recommend those budgets to the citizens of the town in the referendum, which will be held, we're anticipating now, in June. We'll go through the mathematics of this, but the net effect of this will be to set the mill rate when we're done. And then during the year, we monitor the expenditures and approve any additional appropriations. And then we give fiscal oversight to the town and the board of, and the finance department. All right, next. The key criteria for these don't change very much year to year, but to ensure that we have long-term fiscal discipline, we can pay the debt that we incur over time, and that we try to minimize. Something bad happened there. Yeah. We're trying to, we had more Wertheimers on the phone listening in, trying to be sure we had a quorum. A couple of things that we continue to maintain a disciplined level of debt service. And we think about the terms that we finance the capital improvements, especially over time. We've enjoyed a AAA rating from Moody's, and that's very important because it affects our cost of borrowing. And then we try to keep reserves for the unanticipated, and I think we've done a decent job of that over time. And again, cooperation between the boards. If you look at what we've accomplished as a board over the years, as a town, and I think this is to everybody's credit, is that over the last 4 years we've had declining and flat taxes in an environment where it's been increasingly difficult to do that, largely because of fiscal pressures from the state as well as our own. We have a excellent reporting and controls. The town staff does an excellent, finance staff does an excellent job in producing and keeping those reports up to date, and we've received those for over 17 years. Next. So our real job is to balance expenditures and revenues. Seems sort of elementary, but it gets increasingly complicated as elements of both the expenses and the revenues are impacted by things that are not always in our control. So we'll have the two operating budgets presented today, the debt service that's a result of the capital the budget that we commit to over time. And the way we pay for this is with property taxes, largely on real estate, but also on automobiles. And then we have state and grant fee that are major components of this, as well as fees for service within our town. Looking at, we talked about this a little bit last year, I don't want to beat this up, but the governor or the legislature decided to equalize the car tax, and that first impact was last year. Because our mill rate is higher than other surrounding towns, or the average town, which is at 32, the legislature enacted this legislation that allowed us to actually, what the nutshell said, that everybody should pay the same mill rate for their cars because they're the same car. It sort of makes sense. But the problem is that if they're charging 32 mills for the car and we were historically charging 37, 38, we lost money. The state decided to make that up, and they did that last year. Indications are early in this budget that will be done again this year. We don't know how long that'll go. It's a component that we have to consider. The net of this was that even though our mill rate for property, real property, stayed flat, you actually had some benefit from this if you own a car, one or two cars last year in terms of taxes. Next. So what we're really dealing with this year is what we call tipping the scales, and somebody has their thumb, their foot, their whole body on the scale. If you look at the proposed Governor Malloy's budget, I think it's been adequately covered in the press, the pushing down back to the towns of the teachers' pensions was his proposed budget. There were several other components, both positive and negative, But the impact, when you net it all out, was very significant for our town. The budgets that you'll hear today were drawn knowing that the state is going to transfer some of their burden to us, but we don't know exactly how much. And so these budgets have shown some impact of that, but probably not the ultimate impact. And we're waiting to hear from the Appropriations Committee and the legislature what the ultimate structure and level of taxes will be, or support will be from the state. John? The primary thing that the Board of Finance manages is the property tax. That's our key component, and that's always the last thing that's set after the budgets are set. If you go ahead, Sean, we'll move ahead. This is fairly simple arithmetic. You take the total assessed value of the property, you multiply it by the real mill rate, and that gets the amount of property tax that we need to balance our budget. Or if you flip it around, the mill rate is determined by how much property taxes we need divided by the assessed value. And that's the math that we do right after the referendum. All right, next. So the things that are impacting our budget overall are increase in municipal revenue sharing, about 200,000. Cuts to educational cost sharing. This was, again, part of Governor Malloy's budget. That was offset somewhat by an increase to the special education grant. And then the biggest number, which was sort of a headline number, was the transfer back to the town of the teacher's pension proposal. Again, this is Governor Malloy's proposed budget. And this is the only information that we had for both the town and the Board of Ed to begin the budgeting process. All right? Total impact is $4.3 million being, additional costs being pushed back down to the town for us to bear. Next. So that was external. These are internal. The loss, we have, and we talked about this quite a bit last year, the loss of the tax revenue from the Hartford. The purchaser of that building very efficiently and quickly tore the building down before the grand list, and so that impact is being felt. Probably not quite as severely as we had thought, because we're being partially offset by new construction in town that added about 700,000 to the grand list. The car tax we've already talked about, and then both reducing the amount we would have because we have to only charge 32 mills on that, but get reimbursed from that. So again, some pluses and minuses here. So that we had given guidance, the Board of Finance, to both the town and the Board of Ed on, you know, that we would like to see their budgets come in between 0% and 2%. They have made a very good faith effort to do that. But still ended up coming in at about 2.36% over what last year was. And again, each of them will be presenting their own budgets. This is not a problem. These problems are not exclusive to Simsbury. Everybody's dealing with this. And different towns have taken more aggressive action or less aggressive action. But this is based, these were comparable town budget increases last year or this year? This year.
This year.
Right. Yes. All right, next. So again, we have a good track record of trying to hold taxes. I think it's excellent. But we're setting the stage here for a lot of pressure on this year's budget and our ability to hold this. Next. So the difference here, this slide again shows sort of the property tax hole that is going to need to be filled to get to a balanced budget. All right, next. The other thing that we've talked quite a bit about at our meetings, I don't know if we went over this last year, but we have also been using a great deal of discipline on the percentage of our operating budgets that we use for debt service. And we've been moving this line down pretty steadily over time. We were at 7% a year and a half ago. Today we're at 6.7%. And so the challenge or the charge to the town and to the Board of Ed on the capital budgets was to have projects timed and financeable that would fit into this 6.7% target. So overall, the Board of Finance is the oversight board that works with both of the other two boards, and it's our job to ultimately try to keep the expenditures down, be sure we get as much revenue as we can from the state, but ultimately we have to charge the taxpayers and maintain reserves that are appropriate for the town. So with that, tonight we will have three presentations, as I mentioned, and then we'll go to we'll open it to a public audience. So start with Tara. You ready?
Hello. Thank you all very much for coming tonight. I'd like to thank my fellow Board of Ed members, Sue Selina, Lydia Tadone, Tom Frank, Todd Burke, and Jeff Tindall, who are all here, and our educational staff. We've got Matt Curtis, Burke LeClaire, Neil Sullivan, Aaron Murray, Brian White, and Sue Lemke. I also have a couple other principals out there, Meg Evans and Steve Matizek. I'm sorry, I knew this. And tonight I'm going to present an overview of the Board of Education budget. This budget season has been one of the most complicated ones in the state's history. And I would like to start by saying that as a lifelong resident of Simsbury, I'm very, very thankful that I have the people, that we have the people we have, willing to do what needs to be done, to dedicate many hours and great compassion in order to do the difficult work of setting budgets. We all are volunteers. We've all volunteered for this, the Board of Selectmen, the Board of Education, the Board of Finance, and we're very fortunate to have the staff we have and the talented town staff that works with us. And together we come with a singular mission of doing what's responsible and right to maintain the quality of our town. So with that, I'll move on to our budget. This budget is adopted on February 28th, 2017, and the Board of Finance moved it to this meeting on the meeting of March 21st, 2017. The presentation will include information on the major cost drivers, as well as contextual factors impacting our operating budgets. As a district, we work within a continuous improvement framework founded upon our district vision and core beliefs. This is a responsible budget that is supportive of our Board of Education's 5-year goals. This is the budget we've presented, $69,125,170, with an increase of $1,670,601, which is a 2.4% increase. Simsbury's spending per pupil places us in the middle of our comparative district reference group and serves as a benchmark for our spending. We are proud of the fact that our collaboration and collective efforts with the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Finance have led to a four-year flat mill rate. As a result of our continued enrollment decline, we are able to mitigate some of our contractual increases by eliminating 5.6 full-time positions. We continue to monitor our student population and reduce classroom sections wherever is possible. And while our overall student population has gone down considerably over the last 5 years, our enrollment among students with disabilities has stayed much more consistent. Special education has been an area where the board has committed significant resources in the past years. We continue to be proud of the accomplishments of our district and outstanding achievements of our very talented students and staff members. We recognize that the success of our school district is important to the overall attractiveness of our community and are committed to upholding our high standards. Recent ratings by Niche, which share annually, we share this annually, they've put us as number 7 in best school districts in Connecticut, and number 6 is the best high school, one of the 6 best high schools in the state of Connecticut. And a report of recent annual mandated testing demonstrates our students continue to perform at extremely high levels. The majority of our budget costs, 84%, are related to salaries and benefits. While we are requesting 3 new positions this year, our fixed costs alone represent a 4% increase. The proposal supported by the board this year includes both a social worker and a math coach to support our transition to a new elementary math program. Overall staffing levels will be down 2 full-time positions. We are able to reduce our costs by 0.93% by taking advantage of 6 retirements and decreasing 5.6 full-time positions related to our enrollment decline. As a result of monitoring our current year spending closely, we propose utilizing $335,000 currently in our non-lapsing account to help us accomplish the 2.4% increase. We will also plan on utilizing additional grant funding from the Choice Attendance Grant to offset $400,000 in operating costs. This is a snapshot of the major drivers across the broad categories representing the increase of 2.4%. The last slide represents a $3,000 increase in our non-public school budget. The non-public school budget is mandated responsibilities comprised primarily of nursing services and transportation to our private schools. So that is my presentation.
Good evening, everyone. So nice to see you on this dark and stormy night. It's exciting to spend it with friends, and I'm very pleased that you came out to give your voice. As Tara said, this is a really unusual year, so it's really important that we hear from you. I want to thank Rob Pomeroy and members of the Board of Finance for hosting this public hearing, and I wanted to recognize members of the Board of Selectmen. Can you please rise? We have with us Elaine Lang, Mike Payne, Cheryl Cook, Sean Askham, and Chris Kelly. They worked with me in a very collaborative and bipartisan way to put together this recommended budget for you tonight. I also wanted to recognize town staff, and I ask members of town staff to please stand and be recognized. There's a lot of them here. They put in countless hours, and I cannot tell you how grateful I am to them for their help with this budget, but for what they do every single day. Thank you all. That was kind of exciting. Can everyone hear me? Yeah, okay. Today, thanks to the hard work of many volunteers, elected and appointed officials, and dedicated town staff, Simsbury is a top 10 best place to live in America. Others are noticing what our residents have known for years. Simsbury is a great place to live, learn, retire, and do business. Together, we celebrate our outstanding schools, our River to Ridge trails and parks, Simsbury Farms, the Senior Center, the Library, and the Performing Arts Center, summer home to the Hartford Symphony. We have invested in keeping Simsbury a safe and beautiful place to live with our commitment to community policing, well-maintained roads, and stewardship of our natural resources. This budget responsibly preserves Simsbury as the beautiful place we call home in the most cost-efficient manner. This budget proposes an increase of just over $700,000, which is a 3.6% increase over last year's budget and a 0.75% over the total town Board of Education budget. Maintaining existing services, including an additional police dispatcher for public safety and additional staffing hours in the building department for economic development, will require a tax increase of approximately $4.26 a month for the median taxpayer in Simsbury just for the town budget. And that also includes savings from capital debt service reductions that the Board of Selectmen made of about $160,000 there. Here you see how the budget breaks down by departments, with public safety the largest, followed by public works, benefits and liability insurance, general government, which includes central administration, my office, tax, the assessor, town clerk, and registrar of voters, and then the library. In this slide, you see that over an eight-year average, budgets have increased an average of 0.78%, with 3 years in a row of no new taxes, similar to what Rob was saying. That's something I do want to give a lot of credit to both the Board of Finance, the Board of Education, and the Board of Selectmen, who have worked collaboratively and in a bipartisan manner to be able to do that. The goal of this budget is to provide excellent town services that preserve Simsbury's quality of life in the most cost-effective manner. The primary objectives in doing this are sound budgeting, which is fiscal responsibility by delivering quality services as efficiently as possible, providing a safe community and safe services, environmental health, economic health, culture, education and recreation, transportation, neighborhood livability and social health, which is improving the security of Simsbury's vulnerable children, adults and seniors, and high performing government. New in our budget books, which are online, you'll see that all our department goals are tied to these overarching goals. I know the community and the Board of Selectmen share my pride in the impressive and significant accomplishments by those who serve on boards and commissions, volunteers in the community, and town staff. I actually have pages and pages and pages on this, and you can see the full list of our accomplishments in my budget message, which is online, but I'll just go through a few of them right here. We applied for and received over $700,000 in grants for streetscape and a multipurpose trail. Unveiled Open Simsbury Budget Portal, completed a makerspace at the library, facilitated an easement exchange to support the Terrafill water tank replacement, closed two pension plans for new hires and two unions, renovated tennis courts at Simsbury Farms and built a warming center, completed a truck wash and a salt shed at Public Works, completed a joint IT study with the Board of Education to ensure coordination, efficiencies, and cybersecurity. The library completed its strategic plan. The Planning Commission has kicked off its plan of conservation and development, and we installed an electric vehicle charging station in Town Hall. The budget, I'll go on to that. In crafting this budget, careful consideration was given to existing economic conditions locally in Connecticut and at the national level, and you can see a list of the things that we considered when we crafted this budget. This year's budget had two additional challenges. The first on the bottom you see, and that Rob mentioned, is a $1.5 million loss in revenue from the demolition of the Hartford building, offset by some new development for a net loss in tax revenue of about $790,000. Fortunately, the town has been planning for this for a number of years and has set aside some reserves to help cushion this tax impact. The second challenge facing us this year is the governor's proposal to add an unprecedented and untenable $4.3 million in additional costs to Simsbury. Were the governor's proposal fully adopted by the legislature, we would see an additional tax increase of 6% above the expenditure budgets being presented tonight, with an additional mill rate impact of 2.11 mils. The largest and most concerning part of the governor's proposal, and I'm going to take a little time to talk about this because it's super important and it really is an unprecedented proposal. The largest and most concerning part of the governor's proposal is the transfer of the teachers' pension costs from the state to the towns. For Simsbury, that cost alone is $3.6 million. This is a regressive tax transfer that hurts residents in every town and every city, particularly seniors, low-income property owners, and small business owners. Many decades ago, the teacher's pension plan was developed by the state, designed by the state, funded by the state, and committed to by the state. As towns, we had no input and no say. The state failed to meet its commitments and underfunded these pension plans for decades, 70 years, leading to the current fiscal crisis in which the state now faces a $1.5 billion deficit. I'm going to say it again, billion-dollar deficit. To help solve this problem, the state now wishes to shift this cost burden to municipalities. We have been working with our state delegation, Representative Hampton and Senator Witkos, to advocate against this new state-imposed mandate. We do expect that the budget that is ultimately passed by the state legislature will look vastly different from this initial proposal. But like all towns across the state, we won't know the final impact to Simsbury until late this spring, as Rob mentioned, probably at the end of April. We'll have at least better numbers. We anticipate having those better numbers once the Appropriations Committee at the legislature gives their budget, and they give that on April 27th. Rob also mentioned the car tax cap of 32 mils. The primary drivers of this year's budget are health, pension, and Social Security required increases, negotiated salary increases, contractual services like legal services, financial services, GIS, MS4 mandate compliance, Emerald Ash Borer. We actually do have an Emerald Ash Borer infestation in town, and town manager recruitment and other things like that. Increased staffing hours in the building department to meet economic development demand, and the addition of a police dispatch position to meet increasing population needs. And the reason why we're adding that position is so that if you call 911, you're not put on hold. These next few slides, I have that wrong. Okay, hold on. In this slide, you will see that most of the town's costs are people costs, including salaries, pensions, and OPEB and insurance. If the budget was increased by only negotiated salaries and benefits, the total budget would have to increase 3.5%. And you see that the proposed budget is 3.6%. We are fundamentally a service industry, and the town does the work that private companies cannot or will not do because it is simply not profitable. In a word, we don't make stuff for profit. We serve people. The primary savings of this year's budget are a road paving policy shift to road maintenance. We were in a road enhancement mode for many years, and we're going to a road maintenance that is not a road deterioration mode. Elimination of a full-time IT staff position. Electricity savings from the installation of the LED streetlights. We incorporated some of those savings last year, but we're getting the last bit of those savings this year. The elimination of a part-time communication staff position. The elimination of a part-time circulation assistant staff position. Reduction in hours for a part-time police clerk. These next few slides show some additional savings we have made this year and in recent years. In the interest of time, I won't read them all, but you can see them in my budget message online. Broadly, they are savings through regional initiatives, shared services with the Board of Education, who have been great partners, and I recognize them and thank them. Savings from employee benefits. And finally, a list of some general additional savings. Even though the town budget is mostly people, you see that Simsbury is not anywhere close to some of the outrageous numbers you may have seen on television or at the state level. The median Simsbury town employee salary is just over $61,000, and for police, just over $86,000. And pensions are not unreasonable. It's worth remembering that your local government workers are not nameless people, and include our animal control officer, Mark Rudowitz, Mickey and Kathy at the senior center, our librarians who read to your children, the snowplow driver who waves to your children, police officers who help you, crossing guards, Tom Cook and Sean Kimball, who's our director of finance, who actually did a tremendous amount of work for tonight, and everyone else, all the town department heads that stood earlier. Sometimes we think the government workers are others, when they're really our friends and neighbors, people that we know, and this is especially true at the local level. The median tax bill in Simsbury is approximately $7,440 on a $277,000 home, or you pay about $620 per month, the median taxpayer in taxes. If you break that down, you'll see most of that goes to the Board of Ed. The Board of Selectmen is about $124 a month, debt, retirement, fire, and non-public schools. So what does your $124 a month get you? A vibrant senior center, over 2,500 acres of open space, Simsbury Farms, over 7,000 requests for social services, over 35,000 rounds of golf played, a probate court, a library with over 300,000 visits a year, animal control, 165 miles of roads, paved and plowed, a senior picnic, almost 4,000 land records, a performing arts center, 81 miles of sanitary sewer, mowing, roadside and bicycle trails and fields, building maintenance, supportive community events, recreation classes, athletic fields, we have over 40 of them, bridge repairs, two pools, over 800 pool passes, over 33,000 calls for police service, tree trimming, over 2,000 dog licenses, over 16,000 registered voters, tennis courts, vital records, a health district, GIS mapping, school resource officers, over 2,500 building inspections, bike trails, landfill and recycling, 14 snowplow trucks, environmental testing, a teen space at the library with almost 2,500 teens attending library programs, a business resource center, sidewalks, a makerspace, economic development support, 9,000 passengers traveling 64,000 miles on dial-a-ride, an ice rink, and hazardous waste collection. We believe this is pretty great value, especially if you think of what you pay for some of your utility bills, your car payment, if you're like me, your kids' cell phone bills. While each town is different and faces different challenges, we wanted to highlight how Simsbury has compared with some of its neighbors these last 3 years. Working collaboratively with the Boards of Education and Finance, you see here that Simsbury has kept taxes flat for 3 years in a row. Just as we have in the past, we continue to work hard to deliver value in the most cost-effective manner. This budget also contains capital recommendations, including the Henry James Memorial School renovation project, a senior community center, finance security upgrades, Simsbury Farms rink and pool improvements, bridge improvements, library lower level improvements, Simsbury High School tennis court replacements, and other projects which Jeff Shea will detail for you in a few minutes. This chart shows how we compare with other AAA towns in Connecticut in per capita debt. This is good company to keep, and you'll see that we are in the conservative end of debt spending. Rob showed this slide earlier. This slide shows that the funding recommendation we are putting before you fits within the Board of Finance debt policy of 6.7% and includes 10-year bonding for all capital projects other than the Henry James project, which we are recommending funding at 15-year, using 15-year bonds due to the size of the project and a length of use of over 50 years. Finally, I want to thank members of the Board of Selectmen, town department heads, staff, and the Director of Finance, Sean Kimball, and their help in preparing the Board of Selectmen's budget presented to you tonight. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm going to talk about the two Board of Education projects that are part of the town's overall capital improvement project. The Henry James project phase three is the largest one on our list, and it's been a long time in the works. Been pleased to be involved with the first phase of the Henry James project, which was focused on the main office and the hallways. It was completed two summers previously, and if you've been in Henry James, you see that there's a distinct difference between the first floor and the second floor. Fortunately, we received funding for a second phase, which will allow us to do more work on the first floor and also second floor hallway areas. But largely, since 1957, other than some add-ons to the edge to the ends of our buildings, there really hasn't been any changes, and that is some of the reason for looking to not only maintain this building but also add and modernize some of our program spaces. So just a quick highlight of those areas: we have a new library media center that is part of this plan. Also new science classrooms and improvements to focus on our STEM learning, science, technology, engineering, and math. We have an auditorium that is part of this project, and we have renovation of our tech ed and family consumer science wings. Again, those have not been touched since the school was opened. We also do some I guess what we would call light renovation to our basic classrooms. And one of the important aspects of this project would be to actually finish fire suppression throughout the building, which has got a ways to go. So the total cost estimate that the Board of Education has been working on with Castle Booz, the architectural firm that's been chosen, is $22,825,000 roughly. And just to give you a quick overview of the floor plan, just gives you a good visual, if you can see the colors of what some of the major areas are and the scope of this project. So the areas in blue, which I'm going to try to highlight here for you, that is the auditorium. It was actually designed with the intent to have something there. There's a current lobby that you probably know that's in this area there. And that would be a 7,500 square foot, 400 seats. This other blue area is the new library media center, and that is, as you see, 5,800 square feet. The other areas that are in dark green are the most major renovation areas. That's the tech ed, family, and consumer science wing. There's a linkage here because there was a lot of relationship between the types of programs and things that we're now doing in the library media center. You have the other areas in green are the new science classrooms. So those are expanded classroom labs. We'll talk about that in a couple minutes. And the areas in lighter green are just that basic classroom renovation. And all those areas in red are spaces that we don't have fire suppression currently. So the few areas that you see in gray that we're not touching are just the newest areas that had been added to this school. So here's a quick rendering of the science classroom lab concept. Basically, you have both areas for standard classroom lecture as well as lab groups, and not having to break down and set up spaces. This is a little bit of a highlight of that section of the new library media center. One of the keys here is that we're about doubling our square footage from what we have now. And you have enough room for a class to actually be in this space, working, doing a class project, and yet have room for other users, which we don't have that capability currently. We essentially shut down the library if there is one class working there. So we have we have an exterior rendering, essentially in the back of the building, of how that space would look from the outside. This is the same concept from the inside. This isn't a final version. This was earlier on, just showing there would be a much more open space for students to come and research and do various types of work. The last area we're just going to give you a little bit of highlight on, again, is the auditorium space, the rendering of the inside and the outside as you drive into the main entrance to the parking area. So that is a quick overview of that. There was a professional cost estimate done most recently this fall, and it confirmed that the budget remained at $22,825,000 and had been discussed by the board earlier this past summer. So one more project for the Board of Education, the high school tennis court replacement project. For any of you who do use those courts, you know that there has been significant cracking year after year, and we really have learned through this process of hiring consultants to plan and design that there is a serious amount of groundwater and a very low, just several feet below, that is certainly has been part of the reason why it's difficult to keep tennis courts from cracking after years and years of freezing and thawing. There's a post-tension concrete method that's called, and that's part of the reason for some of the cost, but it will ensure that we'll have a longer lasting tennis courts. We want to replace all six courts, and the cost estimate has actually gone down slightly. The $740,000 budget was our first brush, and I have one overview here of an overall site plan of our high school area. So this is showing that the current location of the six courts would be here, and in this project we would be relocating these courts to this section, and it provides us with the opportunities as we do master planning for future improvements to the athletic complex area. We are going through a permitting process at this time. We just went to the conservation group, and we have some more zoning work to do, but the goal is to get it out to a bid so that subject to approval, we'd be able to get the work done by this fall and be ready for next year. That's all we've got.
Good evening. I'm going to run through the townside capital projects proposed for fiscal year 17-18. First category is the capital non-recurring projects. What am I doing here? Pitch down, right? Thank you, Sean. To briefly describe the capital non-reoccurring program, first project is a purchase of a baseball infield conditioner that replaces a 1980s vintage machine that basically grooms all the recreational fields throughout town at $20,000. Next project would be for a purchase of a utility vehicle at Memorial Park that basically provides support services for maintaining and preparing the fields for play at $25,000. Next project is police patrol vehicles, three vehicles that are replaced under a planned replacement program at $95,000 for the three vehicles. Next project would be town hall office improvements. At $49,500, this project is to maintain or to accommodate changes in town staff and to accommodate space for the town manager that will be coming for, very shortly to the town hall. Next project is half the cost of a highway mechanics truck with a utility body. It's basically a support vehicle for maintenance of vehicles, dump trucks, loaders, the like. Half the cost would also be provided through the Water Pollution Control Authority, so it's sort of a shared vehicle for those two divisions. Next project is a replacement highway plow truck with an all-season body, again under a planned replacement program. And the last project is upgrade to heating, ventilation, and air conditioning controls at Town Hall to affect a more reliable system and hopefully save some energy as part of that project. These projects are the capital projects proposed for fiscal 18. And again, these are provided from all the departments and we aggregate them into a program. The Simsbury Farms Rink and Pool Improvement Project is actually the second phase of a project we are is under construction right now. Under phase one, we are completing improvements to the lap pool. We constructed the warming shelter and we also did some refrigeration improvements at the ice rink. This phase of the project will complete the pool project by touching all the rest of the pools with new mechanicals, structural improvements, deck replacement, gutter replacement. So it'll essentially put the facility in good standing for the next 20 years if this project goes forward. In the out years, we actually have some plans to do some additional refrigeration improvements at the ice rink with equipment replacement that'll be required in 2023. Next project is park improvements. This project at $235,000 will provide for various roadway, greenway, paths, and improvements throughout town. There is some outside money that will contribute to this sort of replacement program through the youth sports organization at $70,000. It also includes the washdown area for park equipment that's required under industrial permitting requirements through the state, and also irrigation repairs throughout the park system. Open space planning improvements for $150,000. This project will provide additional funding for site improvements at One Old Bridge Road, which is the property the town acquired a few years ago, and also continue some of the work at the Ethel Walker Woods parcel that was purchased a few years ago in terms of enhancing the trails and public access to that particular parcel of land. Townwide Park Master Plan at $102,000 is, I guess, a set of fresh eyes on the park system. Last time a master plan was done was back in the 70s. The needs have changed and the demographics have changed in town. So we want to take a look and see what the future needs will be and we can plan accordingly through a master planning process. Streetlight purchase slash lighting improvements is a second phase of a project that was initiated last year where we purchased all the streetlights in town. This phase of the project looks more towards our sites, town sites that we own that need attention relative to lighting improvements, both for energy efficiency and frankly for structural useful life. Some of these lights, such as the ones at Simsbury Farms, are just beyond their useful life and are actually collapsing and failing from time to time. We'll also look at some of the other parks and some of the municipal parking lots to initiate some lighting improvements at those facilities also under this project. Next. Iron Horse Boulevard playground renovations, essentially rehabilitation of the boundless playground down in the Simsbury Meadows. Through heavy use, there's repairs that need to be accomplished for that facility to make sure it's safe. The rubberized surface, again, is showing its wear, and the perimeter fencing needs some attention. Plan of conservation and development slash land use studies is essentially the second phase of the POCD, where the planning department will be looking at more specific areas and doing appropriate zoning changes to those areas to affect economic development and enhance the ability for those areas to be attractive to developers. And this is funding to allow that to occur. Zoning regulation update is essentially a continuation of updating our regulations through rewrite of the subdivision and the town improvement standards to, again, allow developers to have more clarity in terms of what would be allowed. And again, to bring it up to current standards, the standards have changed. The mandates have changed, so we would incorporate all that into the regulations to make it more friendly for developers. Finance security upgrades is a multifaceted project that essentially looks at the security of IT, both on the town side and the Board of Education. Includes components including a fraud alert and a cyber security analysis, training for town staff for cyber security, a look at the firewalls and intruder detection systems that we presently have in place and to upgrade those, a finance system upgrade and encryption for communicating, and again, creating an inventory and capital asset technology module as part of that upgrade. A senior community center at $5.8 million includes both a renovation and an expansion of a functional space for the senior activities at Eno Memorial Hall. These are some of the components that would be included in the project. A look at the building envelope to secure that and to make it to extend its useful life, lighting, air conditioning, site improvements, parking, expanding the food closet, signage, furnishings, relocation of SCT TV. And next slide, please. These are, again, some more components of the project, expanding the multi-purpose room for senior activities, creating a health screening room, creating accessible bathrooms at all levels per code, entrance improvements, overall ADA improvements throughout the building. Right now, there's facets of the building that are not accessible and do not meet current codes. Kitchen and bathroom renovations, and again, providing some funding for relocating SCTV to a similar space at some other location to be determined. Bridge improvements for $805,000 is essentially an upgrade to our 16 major bridges. Safety improvements and structural improvements that are required through identification inspections that were done by the state. There is a need to attend to some of these bridges to, again, extend their useful life. A cold storage facility is essentially an unheated storage space that needs to be built to accommodate both public works and police department equipment and evidence that needs to be preserved for ongoing cases. Again, small equipment and the like that is owned by both departments would need to be stored in this location. Dam evaluations and repairs is for $75,000, is a continuation of a project that we've initiated through an inspection program of all the dams. There are dams that need attention relative to structural and safety issues. This funding will provide some additional funding for consulting services to develop the appropriate plans to do these improvements. Town Facilities Master Plan is a high-level look at all the town facilities, approximately 40 facilities throughout town. And create and assist staff with developing a long-term capital improvement plan that is more detailed and provides for near-term improvements that will be required over the next 10 years. Various drainage improvements project is a complementary project to our road improvement program. When Public Works reconstructs or improves roads, there's a need to do underground infrastructure, and this provides the funding to do that drainage work that may need to be repaired as part of the roadway project. Library interior renovations and parking renovations is a project that'll address some of the wear and tear that's occurred at the library since it was expanded in 2008. Project includes a replacement of interior carpeting, repainting of the interior of the library, replacement of bathroom exhaust fans, rehabilitation of the parking lot, doing some tree maintenance around the library facility, and upgrading the telephone system to current technology of voice over internet protocol. system. And the last project on the town site is the library lower level improvements project at $906,000. This is a project that will provide additional meeting space, which is needed for both library use, senior center use, and general town and community use. We anticipate the project would be offset by a state grant that would provide 50% of the cost. And there's also participation from the Friends of the Library for things like furniture and professional services. So this would be accomplished within the existing footprint of the library at the lower level in some unfinished space that is presently underutilized. And I think that's it. Thank you.
We are going to get to your questions and comments, so just bear with us. So I just wanted to make a couple of things clear before we open this up to comment, that the budgets that you heard tonight are the Board of Ed operating budget and the Board of Selectmen operating budget. The debt service is fairly baked in because of the debt that we have on the books, but the Board of Finance has adopted recently an idea of using cash to buy some of those projects that Shay just went through with cash to the extent we can. So that number is pretty well set. The state budget impact is what we've talked a lot about tonight, which is the biggest unknown. But I wanted to just give everybody an overall impression of what will happen if all of these budgets come in as we've demonstrated here. The to-be-determined property taxes, if we were given the full boat of Governor Malloy's bill, would raise, and we answer, and we solve the equation of expenditures equaling revenues, we'd have to raise property taxes on the order of magnitude of 8%. That's a big number. So we had a big meeting a couple of weeks ago where these budgets were presented to us, and there are a few levers for us to pull, but not many. But we're going to have to pull all of them. One is we have to hope that the number that is the impact from the state is less. Hope is not a strategy, it's just hope, all right? You can't live on hope. The second thing that the Board of Finance did, and again, this is part of our fiduciary responsibility, is we gave guidance that these operating budgets have to be cut in order to help us reach this goal. We do not think the taxpayers should bear the full burden of whatever this is by simply raising the taxes. The second, third thing is what I call the third leg on the stool is that the Board of Finance will look at our level of reserves and the planning going forward. We won't, we have to remain vigilant in terms of keeping the right level of reserves. But as I think Lisa mentioned, we did take a nice, a good reserve for the Hartford property. We'll see how that building comes on. There may be a little bit of room in reserves, but we're going to need to pull all of this together. Hope, reduction in the budget, and you know, certainly look at the capital budgets. The capital budgets are interesting. There are big numbers on that those sheets that we all looked at. But they're financed over time, and all with that goal of staying within the 6.7% cap. That doesn't mean that we all have to agree that those are great projects and we should spend them. If we did less, we could probably, impact. It would impact ultimately the level of taxes. But you have to think about how those things are actually paid for and paid for over time. So as you make your comments about the budgets you've heard today, realize that we've already asked or given guidance that we need to be more careful on the operating budgets for certain. And that we will then have a chance to do this again, and the Board of Finance will be interacting with both the capital budgets, the Board of Ed budget, and the Board of Selectmen budget when we have clarity before that. And the last, when we're done with the public hearing, I'll go back and give you the timeline and what we'll be doing from here, because this is unfortunately becoming more and more of an iterative process. And we're not quite to the point where we say, these are it, like it or not, or tell us what you like. Your input will be very important to us as a Board of Finance and to the respective boards as they think about where what the priorities should be. That's why we have these public hearings. So after an hour and 10 minutes, we're gonna finally give you your chance. So if you'd like to start over here or over there, if you line up or just watch, again, please respect the time, make your points, and if your point's been made, you can come up and say ditto or make the point quickly, but we are sincerely interested in hearing what you have to say, all right? So who wants to go first? Joan.
I'm willing to take the heat. First of all, what I did for my comments was divided into the Board of Selectmen, Board of Education, and the capital improvements. So what I would like to do is give you 3 minutes for one and come back if somebody else has a problem, and then return for the other two, if that's okay with you.
Yes, I guess.
We've done that before.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll start with the Board of Selectmen budget, and I was very careful to keep within my 3 minutes. Last year, the Board of Finance directed the Board of Selectmen to place many of the capital expenditures that did not meet the criteria for bonding, to place those items in the operating budget instead of paying for them from the general fund, leading to no tax increases. This year, the Board of Selectmen's budget did not address your guidance and has once again skewed the tax increases. Therefore, the Board of Finance should reject the Board of Selectmen budget and mandate that they rework the budget to adhere to your guidance. The Board of Finance is the taxing authority and should not accept a budget that is inconsistent with your guidance. The taxpayers deserve a transparent budget and not a smoke and mirror budget to create a financing. We can no longer have a myopic view when developing budgets. The long-term fiscal indicators are showing a downhill slide. We now have met a perfect storm. The mill rate was reduced by $20 million, a 1% decrease in revenue. Social Security went up 0.3%, and Medicare medical insurance was increased, eliminating any increase in Social Security. The town medical self-insurance fund was increased by over $1 million due to serious health issues that required additional revenue. I am presently spending $600 a month in property taxes for a modest home and a 6-year-old car. With additional tax increases, many residents will be leaving the town, and the state budget has huge deficits leading to diminished revenues coming to the town. The 7% debt expenditures aligned to the operating budgets is no longer an appropriate tool for capital expenditures and should be reduced. The general fund is being used as a slush fund for extravagant spending to prop up the golf course, performing arts, and many other political entities. As revenues are diminished and expenditures increase, the general fund, which is the savings account, is being depleted, leading to lower bonding rating. The projection that the increased development throughout the town will increase revenues from building fees is short-sighted. Many of the projects will be phased in long-term and should not be used as a spending tool. The economics of supply and demand will determine how many of the approved developments will be developed. Since it appears that the supply is more than the demand, rents will be reduced long-term, lowering assessment, lowering projected revenues. Assumptions made on increased savings have not come to fruition. The budget reflects $150,000 expenditure for cybersecurity. Since all towns have experienced the need for protection, this is an opportunity for regionalization. All towns would receive more security, reduced costs. Since more than half the revenue of Simsbury Farms golf course come from non-residents, capital expenditures should not be included in this, and capital expenditures are not included in the Simsbury Farms Special Revenue Fund, and $90,000 taxpayer revenues are used for the shortfall. The town should be reviewing the need for contracting out the golf course to a management company, as other towns and private clubs have done. The Arnold Palmer and Billy Casper management team has managed many golf courses successfully and gives an additional bonus of allowing players to use many golf courses in the United States and elsewhere. The projections of increased development will increase the population and the need for additional services, increasing operating expenditures in the future. The Board of Selectmen budget is presented as a smoke and mirrors budget that I will not support and the Board of Finance should reject. Thank you. I kept within my 3 minutes.
Thank you. And as you come to the microphone, please state your name and address.
Good evening. So let's follow the rules. I'm David Bush. I live at 4 Catherine Lane. I am chairman of Park and Rec, and I'm here to speak on behalf of the budget this year. First, I would very much like to thank the Board of Finance and the Board of Selectmen, in particular our liaison, Mike Payne. This has been a very, very difficult and thoughtful year, and it's very clear to me in the many meetings that we've attended that everything is being done to develop a budget that is not only fiscally responsible, but also necessary. And part of that necessary is what I'd like to talk about tonight. The operating budget that has been asked for the Park and Rec Division here, or the Cultural Park and Recs Commission, is incredibly reasonable. Jerry Toner, sitting in the back, has cut this to the bone to the point where there are certain projects that aren't even being presented this evening that were on our 6-year capital plan that we had to let go because we know that we don't have the funding from the state that we would normally expect. However, the presentations this evening, these projects are not only necessary and important, but they are well planned. To not approve these particular projects will simply result in a greater cost to the town, and that is what the wisdom of the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Finance has realized. Let me give you some idea. You heard earlier, we're replacing a really new vehicle, a 1988 utility vehicle. How many of you are driving a 1988 utility vehicle? We are replacing a 1989 infield construction vehicle. How many of you have the same? This has been Jerry Toner and his folks stretching our budget to the max. Let's give them what they need to do their job. We have 2,500 acres of open space, and that doesn't even call all of that come under Park and Rec. But I'd still ask that there was $150,000 asked for Ethel Walker Woods. The town bought this property. The town supported the purchase of this property. You must be stewards of this property, and this isn't even on my commission. This is something that is necessary because what is attractive to Simsbury and what brings people into town is our open space and our recreation. So with that, I'll simply ask, we are doing a second phase of a project at Simsbury Farms for the rink and for the pool. It is a necessary and complementary project to the monies that have already been spent. Fiscally irresponsible not to complete it. $235,000 for the improvements to the Greenway. Again, the idea here is there's $70,000 in matching funds from local programs. How do you take one third of the budget and you're gonna say no? That must be supported. There's $298,000 to improve a playground, a boundless playground. Can you imagine the press you're gonna get when that isn't approved? No, I don't think you can. $102,000 for the townwide master plan. You cannot be fiscally responsible without planning, and a plan means you must spend money on planning. Please do so. And finally, the $400,000 street lighting plan. It is the second phase of a plan where money has already been asked for. This is what this town does well. We plan, let that plan go forward. Again, I want to thank the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Finance.
Thank you.
Max. Hi there. My name is Kim Kennedy. I live on Riverwalk Drive. I'm a 17-year resident of Simsbury, and yet, sadly, this is the first time that I've attended one of these meetings. It's been quite an education. However, I do have to say that I serve on outside boards myself, so I do know the time and effort that goes into all of this. And let me start off by saying how much I appreciate everyone here and the effort that they have put into all of this. However, I probably might not be your best friend after I give my opinion, because actually I have to put on my taxpayer hat. In my home, if there isn't the money, it doesn't happen, okay? So I say that, but I have some additional comments through my research that I wanted to share with you. So in review of the First Selectwoman's March 2017 report, she discussed the tax impact from the recommended budgets, and its estimated 2.9 increase. That's on that doesn't include the additional increase that Governor Malloy is talking about, which would be 4.3 million, nearly 6%. So that means that Simsbury property taxes could go up as much as 9% unless something is done, okay? And I appreciate the conversation that you had about the hope and and everything. So having said all that, the First Selectwoman also pointed out that the cost driver of the town's budget, and she's quoted as saying, the priorities and goals are discussed and weighed against what residents can afford. So I find that comment especially concerning, and I'm wondering, would that be weighed against what the upper, middle, or lower class residents can afford? And I believe it to be presumptuous that any government official could decide and tell a resident what they can afford, okay? When beginning with a net loss of what I thought was $790,000 for the demolition of the Harford building, which I don't really understand how we got stuck with that. Now, unless I misheard her, she mentioned $1.5 million. Plus the added uncertainty of an additional $4.3 million in costs from the state, I don't believe this is the time to be increasing any town budgets. Instead of increasing budgets yet again, I believe there should be serious discussion and difficult decisions made around cutting waste and abuse, such as switching to a low-cost, employee-funded, consumer-driven health plan, reducing employee retirement pension matching contributions, dismissing unessential and overlapping staff, instituting salary, bonus, and hiring freezes across the board, spending and improvement freezes unless absolutely vital or self-funded with grants and or donations, removing less popular classroom electives from the curriculum, especially on the high school level, increasing classroom size for electives only, not the core, freezes in current town-wide program funding, self-funding and sustainable programs utilizing volunteers in fundraising and grants, renegotiating any contracts that don't meet the above criteria, and if need be, instituting salary cuts, to name a few.
We're just about at your time.
So. Okay, I just have a small bit more. These are the same difficult decisions that private sector companies make every day in order to lower operating expenses. In private markets, charging customers more is not typically an option. We are expected to do more work with less staff, benefits, and pay. When someone leaves and retires, they are not replaced. The function is distributed among existing employees. The days of providing overpriced salaries and fully funded superior benefits on the backs of taxpayers is antiquated and needs to stop. I don't claim to have the critical answers needed, but I do know local, state, and federal governments are too reliant on increasing taxes instead of making the difficult decisions to close the deficit gap. I urge the Board of Education and Selectmen to reevaluate their budgets to reflect the voice of the constituents. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Marianne O'Neill for Meadowbrook Road. I'm also the chair of the Simsbury Board of the Library Trustees. Since it's established, one, I'd like to say ditto to everything Mr. Bush said. I know how hard the Board of Selectmen has worked in a very difficult environment, and I think all the points that he made are very succinct, so I will not repeat them. I would like to talk, though, about the library. Since its establishment, the library has played an integral part in enhancing life in Simsbury. The library is the community gathering place. Its mission is to educate and enrich the community by providing free and equal access to information, resources, and experiences. The library is a welcoming present for people of all ages and all backgrounds. It is a resource for individuals, families, and businesses. In the past fiscal year, the library had over 375,000 visits. That's an average of over 1,000 visitors a day. This is an increase of 19% from 3 years ago. Program attendance was 52,000, up 86%. And electronic materials circulated were up 19%. Business resource assistance was up 20%. With all this opportunity for public interaction, in the past townwide survey, the library had a customer satisfaction rate of 99.5%. Supporting the library's operating budget will enable it to continue to meet the demands and needs of Simsbury residents. This year, the library submitted two capital projects for inclusion in the town budget. The first is to address the need for more flexible meeting space for the library, town and community programs. Time and time again, the library must turn down requests for meeting space because of limited program rooms. This need was also identified in the library's strategic plan to reflect the current use trends of the library. The proposed capital project, which will be to renovate the unfinished area of the library's lower level to achieve more functional space. The primary work will include the creation of an 80-person flexible meeting program space. The library will be applying for a state library construction grant to help offset the cost to the town. Yet funds are also planned to use for a portion of the cost. The second proposed item is to maintain the library building to ensure a fresh, clean, and professional appearance. The library was expanded and renovated in 2008, and after nearly 10 years and over 3 million visitors, the interior of the library is in need of some minor renovations. This includes new flooring and interior painting throughout the facility. The parking lot is also in need of reconstruction to maintain serviceability and safety for patrons. We remain committed to providing excellent customer service and being the community gathering place. Supporting our budget request will enable us to continue to make the library a safe and welcoming environment for all our patrons, where their lives can be enhanced, their horizons expanded, and the quest for lifelong learning satisfied. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Hi, I'm Kelly Connolly. I live at 16 Sawmill. And I just wanted to touch briefly on the HJMS proposed renovations. I'm a parent and a teacher at Central School. I have three boys there, second, fourth, and sixth grade. My grandparents actually were on Berry Lane, and they raised five boys there. My grandmother taught at the high school for over 30 years. And the middle school simply does not reflect the quality of Simsbury schools. While our scores and our rankings are very high, the students and teachers are doing so under dilapidated and very dated conditions. I can go on and on about the specific details, but some spaces haven't been updated since 1957. The important thing to remember, I think, above all, is that this is a capital improvement project and that the tax implications are not high. It's a big draw, a big reason why people move to Simsbury is for the school systems. It's a huge plug. And the children and the school systems is something that we feel should be considered.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Diana Yisley. I live at 78 County Road. Thank you, everyone, to the Board of Finance, Board of Selectmen, and the Board of Education for your thoughtful budgets that you have proposed this evening. I'm actually speaking in support of both Board of Education and the Board of Selectmen budgets on their capital improvement projects. I will disclose that I'm also a commission member of the Aging and Disability Commission for the town of Simsbury. So on that behalf, I will speak first on support of the Senior Center and the Enar Memorial Hall improvement, which is much needed, especially when you consider it is not ADA compliant, and there are many needs for that building to be renovated to meet ADA codes. And along with that, the Senior Center is, you have to remember, will also be considered a community center and will add value not only to the town, but to the community members. The seniors have been living without any type of true composite center that they can have, and the limited space that they have at the Enar Memorial Hall currently is not sufficient for the activities they do. They often have to outsource, and it's been something that's been put off for over 25 years in this town, and the seniors have been in need of a senior community center. And keep in mind that when we say senior center, it is a community center as well. The renovations that would be happening at Enar Memorial Hall will benefit all the Simsbury residents, because there's many aspects to that, including moving SCTV, which would open more space. And if you look at the designs, you can find them online. They really are needed and would add value to this town for not only the seniors, but all the community members. As Kelly just mentioned, I'm also in support of the renovations at Henry James Memorial School. As somebody mentioned earlier, along with the town facilities, this is phase three of a three-part renovations there. And to leave them without this much-needed third part of the renovations would be penny-wise but pound-foolish. The classrooms are not only antiquated, your science centers in there are in much need of renovation. If we're going to stay competitive in our school districts, these are things that are needed for our students to succeed in the future. The auditorium addition is an absolute necessity in this town. So if anybody has ever tried to use the high school auditorium here, it is one of the most utilized spaces in the town of Simsbury. Not only for people think it's just for theater, it is oftentimes the theater and music departments can't even reserve their own space there because it's utilized by the town, by classrooms, by you have presentations that are made there, academics, college fairs. So by opening up an auditorium at the middle school, not only would it provide the opportunity for additional services, not just for Henry James students, but for the town as well, because that adds additional space for rental usage from private theater groups or presentations or entertainment to come into town that can utilize that space at a rental fee, which would add revenue to the town. And increasing that space, again, is a draw for our town to add more residents to our town, add more entertainment, add more scholastic abilities in this town, which is a driving force for people to move to this community, which is a revenue building source, increase our tax revenue. You have the opportunity to have businesses come to town because of our senior center, because of our Parks and Rec Center, because of our amazing school districts. Businesses won't want to come here if we are declining and we don't no longer keep our A ratings. And to think that we have gone 3 years at a flat tax rate, to consider that we're going to try to do that again is almost ludicrous. We have almost bled blood from a stone in keeping the value and services that we have in town and in our schools at a flat tax rate is unbelievable. And you can't find that anywhere else. So I strongly support these budgets. I understand it may be a tough pill to swallow in this economic times, but it is something that we have to consider, not just for now, but going forward. And some of these projects just can't, you know, be put off anymore. And we have to think of the future of our students, the future of our towns, the future of our residents, and the future of our seniors. Thank you.
Wow, I'm not prepared for that. I'm relatively new to town, and whether I like it or not, I move a lot, so I sit in a lot of these meetings, and I would just like to say that one of the reasons we moved here was because Simsbury offers so much to the people who live here, which I think is so great, and to sit through a meeting like this and hear that we haven't really raised taxes in years actually shocks me. So thank you to all of you for all your hard work. I don't know any of the details behind that, so I'm not going to address it. But one thing I do want to bring up is that We all know the state of Connecticut's hurting financially, and what's being talked about in private corners is how we're going to have to do a lot more consolidating of services through communities, and we know that's going to happen eventually in our state. Simsbury is sort of unique because we're a little bit of an island of doing a really good job of servicing ourselves. But I hope when we're all looking at these budgets, we recognize that the communities around us might join together, and we have to basically be as good as, or even better than, the future of what that looks like. And so I would just ask you all to think outside of just Simsbury and think of the whole state of Connecticut and what we can do to make sure our town remains at least as good, if not better, than what we think will be happening in the near future.
Good evening. My name is Mike Long. I've been a resident of Simsbury for over 40 years, living at 8 Aaron's Way. I've been on virtually every board or commission in this community other than the Board of Education during that 40-year period, and including the Board of Selectmen, including 10 years on the Board of Finance. And I know how hard it is to do a good job on those boards and commissions and how much work it is. So I thank you and applaud you for your work and your efforts in that regard. Tonight I'm here on behalf of the Police Commission, which is where I have been a member for the past 20 years or so. I want to tell you just a little bit about it and then let you get about your work. We have 5 members on the commission. 4 of those members are either chief operating officers, chief executive officers, or head operations officers for the corporations they work for or did work for. The 5th member is our longest standing member. He is our voice of conscience. He is our grounding. He brings us to history and what's gone on before. We have a very good board, a very effective board, and a very cost-conscious board. Our commission works hard with the staff of the police department to make sure that this town has the very best police protection and public safety efforts that it can have. And we're very proud of that. We think it is a nationally recognized police force, and it's a very good community-oriented police force. We look at the proposals that are made for spending money. As I mentioned, we have 4 members who are very cost-conscious, don't want to spend money unless there is a reward that is commensurate with or more than what the cost is. This year, we recommended a budget to the Board of Selectmen, which has been through a process with them and has been passed on to you. We have looked at things such as staffing. This is a growing community now, whether we like that or don't like that. We have grown, our population has, in the past year and a half, 2 years, and it's forecasted to continue to do so for the next 3 or 4 years. Our ratio of police officers to population is one of the lowest in the state and is way behind the state of Connecticut, for instance, which has on an average 2.3 police officers for every 1,000 residents. We have 1.6 here in Simsbury. Of the 12 surrounding towns that are used by the Board of Selectmen and others as comparisons, there's 12 towns. We are 9th down the list. Only Canton, Granby, and Southington have a lower ratio, and it's only 1.5 or so, and it runs all the way up to 2.3. We are not extravagant in the number of police officers that we have on our force. We are not asking for any additional police officers this year, although we are soon going to have to do that if the population projections prove true. What we are asking for is an additional dispatcher and a part-time clerk. And the reason we're doing that is because of the need that we have on the road. It's been forecasted that last year's overdose deaths in the United States will approach 58,000. Now, to give you an idea of how many that is, in the Vietnam War, there were 57,000 Americans killed. So we're killing more every year now from drug overdoses than that war took in its duration. We need the help to get our officers and first responders on the scene, because the largest part of that death count are opioid overdoses. And there's something we can do about those in terms of not curing the underlying problem, but at least keeping people alive who have overdosed on opioids. We now have in our squad cars the ability to administer Narcan to overdose victims. We have in the past 3 years, there have been, I believe it's five to seven deaths in Simsbury from opioid overdoses. We have been called between our police and our ambulance to 17 different calls out for those causes. One was too late to start with, but in the others, there were Narcan administrated efforts, and it saved the lives of all of the rest of those people. But the key to that is timing. We've got to get people out to the call to respond. We're going to stick with the number of police officers we have on the road. We think it'll do for another year, hopefully. But we need a dispatcher, because we've got to, we're overloaded now in our whole dispatch area. And remember what I said, timing is critical. We need to be able to get the call, and we need to be able to dispatch the squad car and or the ambulance. So we need that. That's in our budget. It's been passed on by the Board of Selectmen, and we hope you keep that in the back of your minds, because we do need that. And I don't know what else to say at this point, so I won't say anything else. You know, carry on your good work. I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is David Moore. I live at 18 Bob White Way, Weetog. I am the vice chair of the Economic Development Commission for the town of Simsbury. I am the chair of the Board of Ethics. I am the vice chair of the Simsbury Democratic Town Committee. I am not a spokesman for any of those organizations. I am speaking to you as a private citizen. I rise in support of both the Board of Education and Board of Selectmen budgets that have been presented, with one small exception. I would not ask for any cuts as far as the operational budgets are concerned. The operational budgets provide the actual services that our town folk actually rely on. It is one of the things that has brought so many people, as we have heard, to the town. I came here in November of 2001. One of the reasons why was because it was a great school system. I had three kids. All three of my kids graduated from Simsbury High School. We have one of the best education systems in the state, one of the best education systems in the United States. Education is a constitutional right for our children. We cannot scrimp on that. As far as the town services are concerned, First Selectman Hebner has been able to present to the town a very concise list of things that the town does for its citizens. We cannot scrimp on that either. Where I would caution and perhaps bring out the cutting knife is perhaps some of the capital expenditures that we have not yet begun, maybe those need to be delayed for a little bit. We cannot be, as one person said, penny wise and pound foolish. I'll give you an example. In the operational expenses for the town of Simsbury, the Board of Selectmen have set aside $50,000 for Main Street. Main Street works in conjunction with the Tourism Committee. It works in a commission. It works in conjunction with the Chamber of Commerce. It also is a grant writing machine. You cut the $50,000 to Main Street, you will imperil $600,000 in grants. Don't do that. Where we need to deal with, I'm just It may not be in the proposals, but I'm talking about prospectively, because we don't know what the state of Connecticut is going to do. We have no idea what kind of educational costs they are going to try to foist upon us, and we don't know how that is going to actually impact the overall. I merely cite that as an example. The capital funding is where we are going to have to be careful. Yeah, we need to replace buildings that haven't been renewed since 1957. We definitely need to replace vehicles that have been running since 1988. Some of the bigger projects, however, perhaps need to wait for a little bit. Not all of them. Do we want to have Eno Hall to be ADA compliant? Absolutely. We would then be in compliance with federal as well as state law. But some of the other aspects of that capital funding might need to be trimmed at least for, or deferred, more to the point, for another year. And the other thing that I would point out to my fellow townspeople is that budgets are living documents. They are not things that are set in stone. They can be amended. They can be increased and or decreased as the needs arise. Unfortunately, the state legislature and the governor are putting us in a position where we are going to have to deal with revisions. Thank you.
My name is Mike Rinaldi. I live at 32 Pinnacle Mountain Road, and I can afford this budget, both budgets. But my friends can't.
Speak in the microphone.
My friends can't afford this, but I can. And I'm going to tell you why my friends can't. It's pretty simple. If you look at the cover sheet that we were given, the Board of Selectmen's budget goes up 3.6%, that's 0.31 mils. The Board of Education budget goes up 2.48%, that's 0.74 mils. Together, that's a 2.8% increase, just those two budgets. Now, we can't do anything about the governor's budget, but we're going to have to deal with it at some particular time. As it stands, the governor's cost sharing to us is 1.11 mils, or 2.9%. That's a 5.6%, as you can see, budget increase. Now, we can all go on, on the web and look up the historical inflation rate calculator. Since 2009, the average inflation rate has been 1.37%. In fact, in 2015, it was 0.12%. 2016, it was 1.26%. Now, the inflation rate in 2017 was put up at one of the Board of Selectmen budget meetings as 2.5%. That represents just January. There has been no year since 2009, except for one, in 2011, where the inflation rate has exceeded 1.6%. These budgets combined are in excess of that. So let's give some alternative facts. Number one, the Simsbury Board of Selectmen's budget is, in the past 2 years, it's gone up over 3%. Now, one of the things we have to understand is, about in 2009, the Board of Selectmen under Mary Glassman decided to take road maintenance and repairs out of her budget. She bonded it. That was a 5%, $1.25 million per year, a 5% decrease in her budget by bonding. However, her budgets, although some were negative, like negative 0.1, negative 0.3%, the fact is they grandfathered that bonding into the present system we have now. Now, I'm not against bonding road repairs, but you have to understand why those budgets were flat. Now we're into the 3% range with that bonding still in place. Other alternative facts. From 2013 to 2014, the average inflation rate was 1.11%. The average increase in spending by the Board of Education was 1.44%. That's a 22% increase over the inflation rate. And during this period of time, there was a decrease of 8% of student population at a rate of 2% per year. And in the past 20 years, there has been, in the past 10 years, there's been a 20% decrease in enrollment. We have failed to redistrict, which made this problem, exaggerated this problem. And this is reflected in the per pupil costs, which have exceeded more than twice the rate of inflation over this time. It's a failure to redistrict and maintain class size. Now, let me give you two things which really bother me. I'm all for choice students. I think they bring a great diversity to our community, and I think we have an obligation to provide those children with the advantages of an excellent Simsbury school system. However, one of the best courses I ever took in college was ethics, taught from the natural law. And the book I used was called Right Reason. Now, I'm all for all-day kindergarten. It was instituted about 4 or 5 years ago. But the Board of Education, with Dr. Ullman in charge at that time, decided she didn't think the Board of Finance or the public would go for it. So she used 40 choice students brought in at pre-kindergarten level at the rate of $6,000 per year to fund the program. Over 13 years, that's a $5 million problem. However, if I were told that the reason to do this was to give those kids a chance and a great choice of a great education, I'd be all for it. But it's the means to the end. When the end is correct and the means are fallacious, you have failed ends. It's just simple philosophical tenet. Let me go on.
Let's wrap up a little bit, please.
I have one more point.
Okay, great.
Recently, we were told that we should increase the number of choice students to fill unsubscribed classes in our school system due to the declining enrollment and the lack of redistricting to maintain class size. And I heard someone say, we can use these students to generate income. Imagine giving disadvantaged children, choice students, bringing them to Simsbury so so we could somehow generate income. That's shameful. Choice students should be brought into the school system at the earliest time to take full advantage of our excellent school system and not brought in to plug an unsubscribed seat. Now, I got one point to make.
That makes two.
Okay. The point I have to make.
Trying to be fair. And
okay, I'll quit.
Hi. My name is Becky Mahoney. I live at 16 Park Road. I would like to say that my children attend Latimer Lane. I am the Latimer Lane School PTO co-president. And I wasn't going to say this, but having choice students in our school has been a wonderful enhancement for my children and for the teachers. And I do not see any evidence that those students are being used by our school system or in our town. I've been involved with a lot of choice program activities, and I can't say anything bad about it, and I think it's a winner situation all around. So, but that's not why I'm here. I would also like to mention I'm speaking on behalf of a lot of Latimer Lane parents who could not make this meeting in support of the phase 3 renovations to Henry James Middle School. My family moved here 11 years ago. We were drawn to all the wonderful things that have already been talked about this wonderful town. It's a reason we chose Simsbury over neighboring towns. In the years that we've been here, we have never once regretted that decision, and we are proud to be part of this extraordinary community. In learning more about the Henry James Project, I was shocked to find out there have been minimal to no changes to the middle school, which was built 50 years ago in a different era. Today, our students consistently achieve and perform among the highest in the state and the nation, and our kids are deserving of a facility that will continue to allow them to perform at this level. Our students need a library media center that can accommodate more than one class at a time. They deserve an auditorium where they can rehearse and perform their award-winning productions so that they don't need to be bused to the high school. And I can only imagine how they will flourish in new science classrooms that look toward the future of scientific discovery and encourage participation and enthusiasm in the sciences. These improvements are not luxuries. After nearly 50 years of being untouched, they are necessities. Costs will just continue to rise if we delay these renovations, which will touch the lives of every child in the Simsbury Public Schools as they all travel through Henry James Middle School. Our town is strong because of our schools, and we need to invest in this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'm Scott. I'm from Utah, off Central Road. I think this is going to turn into more of the same. It's a matter of conflicting priorities, and I'm going to provide some of this conflicting. I would actually like to say that one of the reasons I moved to Simsbury was because of the education programs you have and because of the electives. And while we have one parent or one person, taxpayer saying, eliminate some of the electives in the education part. Hey, you know, this is attractive. I'm an example of that. And it may not show it, but I'm also paying above the median of the tax rate. So you attracted someone who's paying a decent amount of taxes. We've also had people say, we had a person up here talking about the library. For the past couple of days, we've been talking to people, about keeping the education budget and some of the examples that we used about saving money. My driveway, Camel to House, and it was great, it lasted for years. And people drive by saying, oh, yeah, we can drive it really neat. I'm looking and hearing that the library needs a pay job. I don't know why it doesn't need a pay job. So, these are the things that I'm bringing out and saying, what needs to be done, what doesn't need to be done. And I definitely personally think that it's just done. A light bulb's all over. Nothing more needs to be said. What I think I would like to hear is a resident in 4 years is a bit more information about justifications for instance, spending $36,000 on a HVAC control. How much energy is that going to save? I mean, how long is that going to take to pay off? I don't know. I can ask. Maybe it is justified. Maybe it isn't. I knew it was raining tonight. So, you never bring your umbrella. But if someone says, we have a hurricane coming, you start going, okay, I need more information. And with this budget from the governor coming down, this potential impact, maybe the hurricane it is, maybe not. But, we've got a lot of people who are wondering, hey, how bad is this hurricane going to be? And what are the contingency plans? And I haven't heard a lot of coming with contingencies could be, and I would love to hear more as to what can be, what definitely can be cut. I totally agree with the person. When you have ADA non-compliance, that's a huge problem. That must be done. But I don't know if you do other stuff. If you did examples here. I've flown in airplanes that are older than 1988. They didn't crash. It just matters about how well they are. The vehicle's actually falling apart in the airplane. So it's just a matter of justification. So
thank you.
Hello, my name is Holly Bem, and I live at 11 Hallview Drive in Simsbury. I know a number of you. I am also an elected official working for free for the town of Simsbury. And I appreciate all the work on the part of our commissions and on the part of our hardworking staff members with whom we've benefited. That being said, I want to agree with the people who have come here before me and said that we need to live within our budget. And when we look at the budget, obviously the largest segment of that is the Board of Education. And using their own numbers of a little over $15,000 per pupil cost, when you lose 391 students, you expect a cost savings of $5.8 million. Now, I've done a lot of budgets in the commercial world. I know that just because a per pupil cost is established, adding one more pupil or removing that person does not bring it down by the same amount. But $5.8 million, and we've never seen one penny of reduction in the budget. I think we have room to reduce the cost. I think that asking for one quarter of that, $1.5 million, is not out of reason. In my work of campaigning for a planning commission and helping several other campaigns, I spent the last 6 years talking to a number of residents of Simsbury about what matters. And in this last year, as part of the Planning Commission, we have commissioned town-wide surveys. I hope a number of you have participated, where we review the same issues that we have also heard on the campaign trail. And I know everyone in the board has also been on the campaign trail. So it will come as no surprise to anyone who has gone through this process that the number one thing I hear constantly going door to door and I don't go to just one party or the other, I go door to door, is taxes. The number two thing is taxes. The number three issue is taxes. And it doesn't matter what neighborhood I'm in, whether they're big fancy houses or small modest homes, it's the number one issue I hear. Now, I probably heard about 300 other issues, I'm not saying that. But there's one issue I never heard. One issue in 6 years of talking to hundreds and hundreds of people, I never heard. And that was, there was a problem with Henry James Auditorium and science facilities, which is kind of interesting because I'm the parent of a student graduating this year from the high school in STEM. He's going to be going into computer science. I have spent the last 6 years, I have an engine, my husband and I have two software companies. We do software development. We have hired interns from Simsbury High School. They're incredibly good. So I didn't even know there was an expansion talked about until just a few months ago. And the first thing I did was go down to the basement, which had a big hunk of our top STEM students hanging out playing ping pong, saying, hey guys, what's wrong with Henry James? Blink, blink, blink. None of the kids who were going into science and mathematics at the college level were aware of any problem. And we had a number of middle school kids in the room. So I question why in an era of declining enrollment, we need all this extra space. Why we can't be a little more clever in configuring our classrooms. Again, I just feel that this is indicative of a mindset that doesn't seem to realize that we are in a budget crisis. Doesn't seem to realize that many of our residents have not seen pay increases in years and are living within fixed means. And so I ask respectfully the Board of Finance to require deeper cuts in the budget. Thank you.
Hi. John Pintoff, East Wheatog Street. I guess I you know, I kind of look around, I may be in a different place in my life than some other folks, so maybe I offer a little bit of a unique perspective. And I have a 3-year-old and a 6-year-old who just started kindergarten, so I'm looking forth, you know, the next 18 years as opposed to possibly a little more of a short term. And I think, well, I agree with a lot of what's said. There are probably some opportunities within this budget to look at what we really need in terms of the long term. I think the education piece is something to me that's, you know, pretty close. And one of the things that I wish I heard a little bit more of is that future vision, because while it may be commented that, you know, what we have may be fine and that, you know, as you look to folks that are entering college, it's been good enough. The world is different, you know, than it was, you know, 5 years, 10 years ago. And what I'd like to see is kind of that vision of how we're preparing our kids, right, to live in that new world. So, well, I think technology is somewhat okay in some of the schools. My son goes to Terrifield School. It's pretty lacking, candidly. And I don't want to compare it to the corporate environment. Obviously, there's more money there, right, to enhance those things and to have that type of stuff. But I do see opportunity to make sure that we're delivering the type of education that's going to prepare our children to be successful at the next levels. And if you compare the technology to colleges, even state schools, University of Connecticut, I got my MBA there at Constitution Plaza, and the work that's being done there. It's night and day what they're working with versus what our children are. So I think it's something that's important to consider, is that somebody made a comment that this is only going to get more expensive over time. There are certain things you can delay, but I think there are certain things I think you need to consider that are important, because, you know, hey, I bought my house for $350,000. It's now worth $300,000, but usually goes the other way, right? So you buy a house in the future, hopefully it's making money. But that's, I guess, a little irrelevant. The other thing that I'd like to see, just an overall comment, is that I this is my first time attending this, and you have the Board of Education, you have the capital expenditures, I have the Board of Selectmen, and I see three different decks referencing the same things with allocations in different decks, and I get really confused, and I'm an underwriter, so, you know, numbers come to me pretty easily. So what I would love to see as just a, and this is not what we were asking, but future is like kind of a consolidated vision with similar formatting that shows, you know, where things get allocated between the decks, the exact dollar amounts, not, you know, I heard $4.5 million in four presentations, and I have to imagine it only hit a portion of each one of them. And then the other thing is I'd love to see is like, you know, my biggest concern, because I am, well, it may not sound like it, I'm very fiscally conservative, and I balance my own budget, and what I would love to see is the vision of Simsbury. My biggest concern at the state and the federal level is that we have these $1.5 billion deficits, and the money, like, I have no guarantee that if I pay more in taxes, that money is going to be spent appropriately. I always said, and again, not everybody can sit here and say this, and I feel fortunate, is that I would pay more money in taxes if I felt confident that the government, and this isn't Simsbury specific, was going to spend that money to make the future better for my children. I don't always feel that way. I feel that things aren't bid out correctly. I know we talked about the $22 million Henry James, which I do actually think is important, at least parts of it, for sure. But, you know, is that the best price for the best value? And then I do look at stuff like, you know, regionalization. I know we have our own dispatching for, I think, police and fire. Is there opportunities there to provide the same level of service? You know, because 911 has to pick up, and candidly, my brother-in-law works for a 911 dispatch center in Torrington. It's important, but are there ways to kind of spread those costs across towns and partner? But I guess the long story short is I'd love to see the vision, I kind of tangent a little bit, is when you say that taxes are going up 8%, worst case scenario, I'll use some air quotes, if the state follows through with that budget, is what's the vision of 2019, 2020, 2021? Because if we're looking at an 8% increase year over year over year, that's different than a one-time 8% increase to get us in the right place. And that I didn't see, and I'd love to see that. And then I'd also love to see in the decks, like the follow-up of, we projected this year, and maybe I missed it because there's a lot of information I got. We projected this year in 2016, and how did we do on that, right? Are you guys being accountable in terms of, you know, that budget? So I didn't plan on saying this much, but I appreciate all the time and effort that goes into this. I know that everybody here comes from a different perspective, and hopefully we can come to something that's best for everybody in Simsbury, but thank you all.
Thank you. John, I know you'd like to go. It's watching the clock. We try to have efficient meetings, so if you'd like to sort of get near the end here, we can.
Can I do both at the same time, the Capitol and the Board of Education?
Yes, you may. I'll give you 4.5 minutes to do it.
Thank you. Joan, I'll give you my name too. Joan Coe, 26 Whitcomb Drive. Simsbury schools have witnessed a decline in enrollment over the years. In 2011, the Board of Education contracted with Peter Prouder to project the students' enrollment to 2021. This projection has held true over the years, and it states, and I quote, "I project that the enrollment decline that started in 2006 will continue. By the year 2021, enrollment will be about 3,520 students. The last time enrollment was below 3,600 students was 1962. The projected 10-year decline is 1,145 students, or almost 25%, end quote. The present decline in 2017 enrollment is 873 students. That's from his account. Open choice students enrollment is 165. This is included in the enrollment projections. In keeping with these projections, when will the Board of Education consider reducing administrative staff as a prudent and effective budgeting tool? The school budget reflects a 6% increase in special education, which I feel is needed from my observations. As we have all heard, it has taken a village to raise a child. A school system is an integral part of the student's community. Coping skills are as important as the core curriculum. The special education department not only provides assistance to students with chronic health issues, but is an intervener to provide assistance to families in crisis. There has been an increase in family violence, divorce, drug addiction, alcoholism, depression, and anxiety, attempted and successful suicides, along with other mental health issues in the Simsbury community. Losing a job due to companies downsizing affects families and affects students' ability to learn. Family health with long-term illness and untimely deaths affects students. The students affected by these issues need support services by school staff. Many families have received assistance from social services in 2016. They have distributed food to 7,325 people and energy assistance to 209 families. Distractions at home affect the ability to learn in school. The school's responsibility is to educate the students by helping them cope with issues that affect them on a daily basis. This takes individual intervention in a timely manner and is costly. This money is well spent. Can I continue with my capital? Capital budget. Many of the 11,460,548 town projects and the capital projects should be eliminated or moved to the operating budget. Some of the money is appropriated for studies, plans, and updates that can be deferred, eliminated, or placed in the operating budget. They are not capital expenditures. There's 1 million dollars of expenditures for the removal of SCTV from the town, from Eno Hall, would be greatly reduced if it is moved into the basement of the library, where the plans have already been developed for the 2,900 square feet of space. This move would leave 1,600 square feet of usable space in Eno Hall, with an elimination of the need for the $5,800,000 renovation for Simsbury Center that does not have a public consensus. The $906,048 library lower level improvements should be eliminated. SCTV's move to the basement of the library would be a long-term solution for SCTV and the community and greatly reduce the capital expenditures. There is a public consensus for placing SCTV in the basement of the library. The Board of Finance should reject these expenditures. The $22 million proposed expenditures for the renovation of Henry James Middle School should be removed from capital expenditures. However, here's another show and tell. The $740,000 for the replacement of the Simsbury High School tennis courts is a safety issue and should be approved. This is the picture of the cracks at the Simsbury High School tennis courts. In an uncertain financial climate with the state reducing revenue to the town, the Board of Education's capital expenditures should be deferred for a year until the Board of Finance can develop a strategy to absorb the millions of dollars reduced from the state. The town capital expenditures should be rejected with only safety improvements approved. All the bricks and mortar expenditures that are proposed in the capital expenditures will increase the debt for 10 to 15 years and add to the operating budget's long term. Many of the proposed capital expenditures should be moved into the operating budgets, not taken out of the general fund to diminish the tax increase short term. With a huge cloud of uncertainty from the state and federal government, I am asking that you defer most capital projects for a year. Maintenance expenditures that are related to safety should be approved. The Board of Finance should do their job and reject the budget until the town has an understanding of the state budget and the implications of millions of dollars of reduced revenues from the state. It is your responsibility to guide the boards through an uncertain fiscal climate. The taxpayers can no longer support a field of dreams. Do your job. And all of my comments will go on Simsbury Patch, Simsbury News Feed on Facebook, Twitter at Joan Coe, and Simsbury Forum topics if you didn't quite get the entire speech. Thank you for listening, and I think you should look at these.
Get those tennis courts. Good. Can you put back up the wrap-up slide?
Use it.
Have a couple more. All right.
Mike Rinaldi, 32 Pinnacle Mountain Road. At the end of the discussion on the budgets, one of the comments was made that obviously these budgets have been remarkably good in the past 3 or 4 years because we had a flat mill rate. Well, how do you get a flat mill rate? I tell you how you get it. You get 98% of your collection rate, you extend it to 99% of your collection rate. That's a lot of money. And then you get reserves. You take your money out of your reserves, you pay for additional expenses, and you apply it to the overall budget. That's how you get a flat mill rate. That's very little to do with the expenses. We have a town that has the 11th highest equalized tax rate in the state of Connecticut. Now, you have to understand what the word equalized means. If you have a car, even a kid from Hartford knows that if he buys a new car, he gets a post office box in Farmington and registers it there. That's why the governor said 32 is the mean in the state, so therefore people won't go registering their cars in low tax state or towns. We in Simsbury had a chance over the past 10 years to do something about that, and we didn't. We used means that we can't hardly use anymore. We can't get the collection rate much below 99%. And our reserves are going to be drawn down when it comes to the governor's budget and the decrease that we get in funding. Now, the problem is we're going to have to use reserves. And my recommendation is that both budgets come in at 1.6%. That's a 0.5 mil increase. Anything that the governor dumps on us, that we pay half out of reserves and half the taxpayers. So we could run with a mil to a 1.2 mil increase. That's still over 3% increase when you have an inflation rate under 1.6. We have to control our means in our expenditures. Now, two things about the projects. One, no one in their right mind would build a senior center that looks like Eno Hall. That's insane. If you walked up from the parking lot to Eno Hall, that's a modified stress test. You don't have to go to a doctor to get a modified stress test. That's a modified stress test. That's not the proper venue for a senior center down on Iron Horse Boulevard in the parking lot. That's where it should be. And coming to the Henry James School, I'm an advocate for education, and I believe in the renovation of Henry James School. But when you have a chance to renovate that building, you should renovate it so it incorporates the sixth grade. Many towns are doing that because the curriculum actually it can be easily incorporated into that. The state of Connecticut agrees with that. We have a chance to do that. And what are we doing? We're building an auditorium. We need Henry James School to be renovated and remodeled to incorporate the sixth grade. We need a 1,000 student building. And then we have to look at the other schools in our system, the grammar schools, how we can make them more efficient. How do we juggle the populations where these kids are redistricting so we can make a grade K through 3 school or a 3 to 5 school? It would be cost effective to do that. Many towns have that. We're so far behind the ball here in Simsbury. We haven't had an original idea in this town for 20 years. So what's happened? At the last election, the voters in this town said we need professional management at the Board of Selectmen. So we have now, starting December, professional management. Okay, I just want to say what we should do with the Board of Education. We need an elected Board of Education. We can't go to the polls every 2 years and they have four people running and it says pick any two and all four get elected. This is an institutionalized board which has no concern with the taxpayers. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all your contributions and for staying to hear everyone's. Appreciate it, those that were able to do it. I did want to just wrap up by outlining what happens next. We have another Board of Finance meeting April 18th, where we will continue to discuss these items. We're expecting some sort of indication from the Appropriations Committee and the legislature by April 27th. So that we'll do this again, probably not as grand a fashion, but at a second public hearing, which will be May 16th, tentatively scheduled. At that time, we will have given good guidance to the Board of Ed and the Board of Finance based on the guidance or the information we, further information we have from the state. And at that meeting, we'll be followed by a Board of Finance meeting, which we will then recommend the budgets that we approve to the referendum for the public to vote on. So that would be the three budgets and the capital budget. All right. Thank you. Any other questions? What's that?
So I move that we close the.
Oh no, we have to. We need a motion to. We need a motion for the public hearing on May 16th.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All right. Any other? Sean. All right. And then we need the most important motion is. And a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.